Thanks to CuriosityStream for sponsoring this video.
If you're a phone geek like me, you must have noticed it already. India gets many of the coolest phones these days. Just to name a few, Xiaomi and Oppo have both built whole new brands for India with Poco and Realme, and Samsung made their super aggressively priced M series phones here. And not only do these India first offerings put the devices we in the West have to shame in terms of price performance ratios, increasingly they're also made in India. So in the 48th episode of the Story Behind series, let's explore why the Indian smartphone industry has become so competitive, and if the company can take this smartphone boom to the next level and become a true smartphone superpower. A quick note before we start. This video will reference a ton of statistics, government policies, articles, so if you want to explore those yourselves, I've actually linked a ton of sources in the description of this video, so take a look at them. Alright, back to the video. India actually already had a brief moment with homegrown smartphone brands a few years ago. Back in 2014, over two-thirds of the phones in the country were sold by Indian brands like Macroeconomic, Carbon, Intex, and Lava. And that same year, Macroeconomic actually managed to outsell Samsung for the first time ever and briefly became the largest mobile brand in India. The explosive domestic success didn't last very long though, as just a year later, Samsung reclaimed the throne and Chinese brands like Xiaomi, Oppo, and Vivo started entering the market. Turns out the Indian brands didn't really stand a chance against this new onslaught, as their whole strategy was just to buy ready-made phones from second and third tier manufacturers in China, stick their logos on them, and sell them to consumers in India. Of course, that didn't hold up against brands like Xiaomi and Oppo, who had large R&D facilities, extensive control over their own hardware, as well as deep, deep pockets for their successful operations in China. According to this fantastic article by Gadgets360, when Chinese brands like Oppo entered the market, they initially paid up to $110 per customer acquisition, compared to the $3.2 some local brands were paying at the time. That is an insane 30x increase in marketing spending, even if it was a temporary one. In a similar vein, Xiaomi didn't spend much on marketing, but had no trouble losing money on phones for years in India to build up its brand and to drive competitors out of the market. None of the more simple Indian companies could keep up with either of those, so it is no wonder that by now they have lost ground and only Micromax occasionally makes it into the top 5. But in their frenzy to outspend and outcompete each other, these foreign companies quickly realized that in order to win in India, they needed to invest more and more locally. Samsung, Oppo, Xiaomi, and Huawei now all have local R&D facilities in India, even if they're somewhat small, and all major brands now assemble the majority of their phones sold in India domestically. In fact, Samsung has recently opened the largest mobile manufacturing plant in the world by output in India, and Foxconn, the world's largest electronics manufacturer, has opened up multiple factories here, including ones for Xiaomi and even for Apple to assemble some high-end iPhones. These phones, while assembled in India, still use components that are mostly imported, but that's a major step forward nonetheless. So, in a sense, things have kind of come full circle. Instead of Indian companies selling phones made in China, though, now it is Chinese and Korean companies selling phones made, and to some extent, developed in India. That is still far away from India having its own Samsung or its own Xiaomi, but it is a significant revival of the industry. So let's take a look at why this revival is happening. It starts with macroeconomic factors. India has over time become the second largest smartphone market in the world, and it is the only large one that is growing significantly. All other major regions are suffering declines, so India has become crucially important as a market. At the same time, China, the original factory of the world, is losing its attractiveness as a manufacturing hub, with manufacturing wages having tripled over the last decade or so, environmental and labor rules getting stricter, taxes rising, and the US-China trade war in full swing, companies are more eager than ever to move their factories out of the country. India, together with Vietnam and other Southeast Asian countries, are logical destinations, and indeed, India has recently toppled China to become the largest recipient of foreign direct investment in the world. Seeing the increasing attractiveness of India as both a market and a manufacturing hub, the Indian government has implemented the so-called Make in India strategy. Make in India covers many industries, not just phones, but in this video, we'll just focus on the parts that impact phones. Under the plan, the government simplified taxation and labor regulations, it encouraged infrastructure development, and it made it significantly easier for foreign companies to invest into India. It has introduced the so-called phased manufacturing program, which is a step-by-step plan to incentivize phone makers to bring their manufacturing to India. Step one of the program is to first slap import tariffs on finished phones coming into the country, but let components come in mostly untaxed. This is supposed to encourage phone brands to assemble their phones in India from imported components first, and it seems to have worked very effectively. India has recently become the second largest phone manufacturer in the world after only China. There are now well over 200 manufacturing plants across the country, up from just two a few years ago, and the ratio of imported devices dropped from 78% to below 18%. Step two in the program is slowly implementing import duties on components one by one to also encourage the domestic manufacturing of these individual components, not just the assembly of them. As you can see, the government plans to start with simpler components like chargers and batteries, and is planning to add increasingly complex components like microphones, printed circuit boards, camera modules, and touchscreens over time. Progress with this step has been made too, but it's slower than expected. According to Counterpoint Research, India still imported $13 billion worth of components in 2018, which accounted for 80% of the value of the phones made in India. And domestic components manufacturing is lagging behind the planned output significantly. While the first two stages have seen some success, the third and current stage, which is the most important one as it accounts for 62% of the value of these devices, has seen very little success so far, meaning that the more complex components are still mostly imported. The first PCB manufacturing plants in India are already being set up by companies like Vivo, but things are taking longer than expected. Either way, despite being slightly behind schedule, I think the direction is pretty clear. India went from being a completely import-driven phone economy to having a reasonably large manufacturing sector, and there are no signs of a slowdown. In fact, the government has set the goal of manufacturing 500 million phones in 2019, of which it wants to actually export 120 million. Now, I think that's a little optimistic given that we're pretty deep into 2019 and we haven't seen a lot of exporting activity yet, or at least I couldn't find it, but it is an impressive state nonetheless. Now, the last question is how this smartphone boom will impact Indian companies, because having foreign companies manufacture stuff domestically is of course better than nothing, but can't on the long term be a sustainable strategy. I personally think that big homegrown success stories will take a significant amount of time to develop, and I also feel like India might be a little too late to build its own, you know, major smartphone brand. This market feels very mature, extremely competitive, and extremely oversaturated already. But there are other areas that we could see promising Indian companies in. In fact, I think the first crop of them have already arrived. Reliance Jio, a gigantic Indian conglomerate, has wiped the floor with competitors in the smart feature phone business, with its homegrown Jio phone line selling tens of millions of units out of nowhere. And while these aren't advanced smartphones per se, they are hugely important for the Indian market. Similarly, Signalchip is the first Indian company to bring microchips to the market. They are currently focusing on 4G and 5G modems and microchips for base stations, which are the units that beam radio waves for mobile networks around, and it is still unclear just how good their chips really are, but the fact that an Indian company was able to design and bring something as complex as semiconductors to the market at all is a massive step forward for the country. And as foreign companies bring more and more knowledge and capital into the country, as infrastructure and supply chains get better, I see no reason why similar success stories wouldn't become more common in the future. Success breeds success. And I'm really positive about the outlook of Indian tech companies. One last way I'd like you to think about the rise of Indian tech companies is through this model of technology transfer that I admit I just made up. Let's take a look. Typically, the more complex a technology gets, the more profitable it becomes to make it. Countries and companies typically work their way up this ladder, chasing each other over time. And what we're seeing is India entering at the bottom, taking away some of the low-end assembly work and simple component manufacturing from China. China is moving up this ladder, making better and better phones like the Huawei P30 or the Oppo Reno, for example, squeezing companies like HTC, Sony, and LG out of the commodity smartphone business. Korean, Japanese, and Taiwanese companies are also trying to move up the ladder, focusing more and more on high-end semiconductors, memory chips, camera sensors, and so on. Of course, all of this is kind of an oversimplification, but I think it illustrates quite well how countries and companies have to move up this value chain quickly enough to offset the losses that they see at the bottom end. And it'll be really interesting to see how quickly India can take over parts of China's old business model while China is trying to encroach on those of the others. And talking of encroaching, I've recently spent a ton of time on CuriosityStream binge-watching documentaries like this one, which explains how the first picture of a black hole was taken and how black holes work in general, which is something that every geek should know. You can watch it or any one of CuriosityStream's over 2,400 documentaries and non-fiction titles for free for 31 days using my links in the description. CuriosityStream features original content from Stephen Hawking, Jane Goodall, David Attenborough, and many more. It was founded by the founder of the Discovery Channel and works on essentially every device ever, including computers, phones, and smart TVs. It only costs $2.99 if you decide to pay for premium after the free trial month. So if you're ready to binge some high-quality documentaries, then go to curiositystream.com/techaltar and use the promo code TechAltar to get 31 days of free premium access to CuriosityStream and to support my channel as well.